Well, it was right at the beginning of my graduate studies in theology here in Innsbruck, after weeks, actually months of discussion, my supervisor, Jodosz Nibiromski, and I had finally agreed on the topic for my dissertation. The preliminary title was to be The Rehabilitation of Sacrifice, and I was to be working on the dialogue between René Girard and Raymond Schwager, which famously, at least in Girardian circles, made Girard reconsider his originally firmly rejection of the concept of sacrifice in the context of Christian tradition. The great thing was that I would be able to use their then still unpublished correspondence, which had been collected in Innsbruck for future publication in a critical bilingual edition. Naturally, I was excited. Only a PhD student with this correspondence, I had the chance to gain absolutely new insights about what Girard himself considered to be the most important change in the epistemological architecture of his mimetic theory. The experienced teacher, Jodosz Nibiromski, obviously felt that this overexcited student seriously needed to calm down. He told me, "Before you do anything else, read Girard's text about this dialogue in the 1995 Festschrift for Schwager's 60th birthday. Find out what he says in there about how Schwager made him reassess the Christian concept of sacrifice. And then do nothing but summarize this text. Right now, I want no criticism, no evaluation, and no allegedly new insights. I just want a good summary from you to make sure you understand what Girard is actually saying." Well, a bit taken aback, I started to read. Right at the end of the text, it said that Jodosz Nibiromski had translated the original French version into German. Luckily, a few years after this German Festschrift, the French original text was also published. I got it from the library and started to compare it to the German translation. Busy trying to hide before myself my ambition to find at least something to criticize philologically under the pretenses of scholarly precision, if I wasn't allowed to utter criticism concerning the content, I was thrilled to discover that my very own supervisor had translated a French term in a way I found unsuitable. Now I know it not to be even a minor detail. Back then, however, glowing with pride, I made this discovery one of the major points in my summary and handed it in. When, a few days later, I came to Jodosz Nibiromski's office to talk about it, he welcomed me with his typical broad grin. He jumped up and cried gleefully, thank you, you have done a wonderful thing. You managed to make me feel like one of the greatest artists of all time. You made me feel like Caravaggio." He took out a picture, showed it to me, and went on to tell me, "This is Caravaggio's depiction of the moment right after David had killed Goliath and severed his head." But Caravaggio not only knew art, he also knew the mindsets of students when it comes to their teachers. He gave Goliath a severed head his own features and painted David in the likeness of one of his students. And he continued with roaring laughter, "Thanks, my dear David, for severing my head." Jodosz Nibiromski was not the first one to find out that the most difficult thing about being a teacher is neither acquiring the necessary knowledge nor applying the appropriate didactics, but the student. A historically vastly popular but simplistic and deceitful version of this is the teacher's moralistic myth about lazy, untalented, and probably worst of all, ungrateful students. This approach has a very long tradition. It is probably as old as the teaching profession itself. Egyptian papyri record the scolding of unable students by their teachers. And as is well known, so do loads of more recent books written by teachers who are frustrated. In between, uncountable numbers of texts of varying quality were produced and established a proper literary genre revolving around the topos of the bad student and the accordingly suffering teacher. Probably the best known example remains Philipp Melanchthon's De Miseriis Pedagogorum, on the miseries of teachers, from 1533. In this little book, The famous educator Melanchthon did his best to describe the intellectual incapacity of students who made their teachers' lives worse than the lives of prison inmates. Today, of course, this traditional scolding of the student is usually done in a more politically correct way by tracing back the student's intellectual inability to socially disadvantaged contexts. The strategy as such has generally remained the same, however. There are heaps and heaps of tracts like Melanchthon's. The fascinating thing is, however, that almost 2 millennia earlier, Plato's Symposium had already begun to deconstruct this rather superficial blame game, or in Girardian terms, scapegoat mechanism, by changing the perspective on the teacher-student relationship, that is, by giving a voice to the scolded student. The Symposium famously depicts Socrates' overambitious but obviously intellectually incapable student Alcibiades, who passionately denied that his intellectual shortcomings were, in the end, his own fault. On the contrary, he insisted that they were very much his teacher's fault. He violently blamed Socrates for not giving him full access to the treasures of wisdom hidden in his, Socrates' chest, like desirable golden idols, he writes. Not even in exchange for sexual favors. He was sure that Socrates had deliberately hidden his deepest insights from him, thus making his life miserable. In turn, he wanted to make Socrates' life miserable. Socrates, of course, denied this vehemently. In fact, his philosophy as a whole, at least as far as we can reconstruct it from Plato's writings, pretty much consisted in the claim that there were simply no such golden idols in anyone's chest, meaning that no one possesses wisdom and can pass it on like a tradable good. So, Alcibiades was wrong about his teacher, of course, but his misconception opened up new perspectives on the student-teacher relationship. What Plato tells us by detour of this erring student's perspective in the Symposium is that the main problem of the teacher-student relationship is not the unqualified student, but the overambitious student, insofar as he is in a relationship of potential or acute rivalry with his teacher. The real problem, therefore, is the student who idolizes his teacher and at the same time self-deceptively cannot get over the impression that his teacher model is not willing to share his deepest insights. Socrates knew, therefore, that being a teacher is a dangerous business because he knew students like Alcibiades. This is probably the reason why he did not want to be seen as or called a teacher. He had come to realize that by their very status in the teaching profession, teachers provoke their students because in the students' eyes, teachers are not only the mediators of knowledge, but also their most serious rivals who ultimately deny them full access to the wisdom they possess. His task as a philosopher, he concluded, was to overturn this teacher-student dynamic and show that wisdom could not be acquired from any one teacher, but only by self-reflection. It would be fascinating to reconstruct in detail how this important Socratic Platonic insight was adapted in Christian tradition. Suffice it to say that building on Jesus' saying not to call any human being one's instructor, for you have one instructor, the Messiah, Christians in the first centuries AD rejected the profession of the teacher for themselves, not only because teachers were required to teach stories of pagan gods. Christians were also concerned about the dangers of the contest for knowledge in the school. These dangers, they saw, were too severe, especially for the eager student who was in danger of seeing the teacher instead of Christ as the incarnation and, over time, like Alcibiades, as the unjust withholder of wisdom. This was not to have any place among Christians. This is one of the reasons why the establishment of a specifically Christian school system outside episcopal instruction in liturgical contexts, most prominently under Origen in early 3rd century Alexandria, was very controversial among Christians. The church fathers, at any rate, tended to reserve the title of teacher to Christ. He was the only one to show the way of life to fullness. In De Magistro, Augustine even argued that Christ was not only the indispensable external teacher of religiously appropriate behavior, but also the magister interior, the inner teacher, who was at work in all acts of theoretical knowledge. Human words uttered by a teacher, he argued, actually could not teach others. They could only tease others to turn into themselves and thus be instructed by Christ from within. Or to put it in Girardian terms, containing the potential mimetic frenzy of the teacher-student relationship should be achieved by declaring that the only relevant teacher did not belong to this world, but to the realm of transcendence, making mimetic desire follow the rules of external mediation and therefore making it far less likely to escalate. Then, in the Middle Ages, things got more complicated. The twists and turns of the respective developments are intriguing, but too complex to detail here. The result, however, was this, the introduction of scholasticism with its logic of the school, including the important role of the teacher. In the 13th century, Thomas Aquinas wrote his famous disputation, De Magistro, where he argued against Augustine that despite all theological reservations, it was proper to call a human school teacher exactly that, a teacher, someone who can pass on knowledge to others. At first glance, this is rather surprising because in the 11th and 12th centuries, the rise of ambulant teachers like the notorious Abélard had caused considerable disquiet in both church and society. The problem was, many felt, the replacement of the traditionally strong monastic relationships in educational contexts by new concepts of teaching with a strong teaching figure, which were prone to give way to the subversive attitude of Alcibiades towards his instructor. The Middle Ages, however, decided not to solve this problem like it had been solved in classical antiquity, that is, by dissolving the role of the teacher altogether, by at least theoretically overcoming the sophistic teaching culture with its strong teaching figure. On the contrary, the solution should be a very strong teaching figure, but also the integration of the student-teacher relationship into a very close-knit schooling order. This hierarchical order, which made the teacher virtually unavailable to the ambitious student, could do away with the potential for mimetic frenzy among teachers and students. This system eventually collapsed in the 18th century and gave way to a groundbreaking new insight. In his 1807 Phenomenology of Spirit, Hegel wrote about the master-slave dialectic, describing that not only did the subordinate desire to be like his superior, but also the other way around. The master's approach to reality is also mediated through the slave. In the schooling context, this meant that the problem of the student-teacher relationship was not the lazy student, simplistic teacher's myth a la Melanchthon, or the evil teacher withholding wisdom from his student, the more complex but still erroneous student's myth a la Alcibiades. The problem was far more serious than that. In fact, both the student and the teacher were entangled in the master-slave dialectic, making them see each other as the ultimate obstacle when it came to getting to the truth of things. Hegel was sure that this could be solved by reason. One René Girard was not. His 1961 book, Deceit, Desire, and Novel, was in a way nothing but an elaborate critical study about this concept of Hegel's, showing that the pitfalls of mimetic desire disabled every attempt to overcome the master-slave dialectic. Any such relationship ultimately makes each and every one the slave of the other. Living in a postmodern world beyond the applicability of the techniques of scholarly hierarchy from the Middle Ages or of philosophical renunciation from classical antiquity and early Christianity, Girard concluded these fatal dynamics doomed all relationships into catastrophe, especially the teacher-student relationship. Every ambitious student and every ambitious teacher are doomed to be drawn into destructive rivalry because each wants to rise above the other in the search for truth. Not only does the student feel that his teacher does not allow him into the sanctum of his wisdom, The teacher feels threatened by the desire of the student to rise ever higher, probably even higher than himself. In this perspective, the unthinkable happens, and Socrates becomes like Alcibiades, and there is no way out. After all these years, I still wonder what Józef Niewiadomski actually thought when he was reading my pretentious summary of Girard's text. Did he experience a Melanchthon moment sighing about a student who would not or could not do what he had been told to do? Did he feel like Socrates feeling unjustly scolded by an overambitious student who used scholarly pretenses to utter criticism against him? I do not really know. What I know, though, is that Józef Niewiadomski had back then, and still has to this day, the rare gift of mastering the arts of being a teacher without fueling the mimetic processes in the teacher-student relationship, but, to the contrary, transform them. I guess one reason for this is that he knows from personal experience what it feels like to be an overambitious student under an ingenious teacher, and also how this can be changed. He likes to tell the story of how, as a young research assistant of his teacher, Raimund Schwager, he had been told to check the quotations from the Bible in the manuscript of Must There Be Scapegoats by Schwager. What he actually did, though, was using the opportunity to express fervent criticism against his teacher. He wanted to show Schwager that he was reading the Bible perfectly wrongly, because he was referring to this obscure Frenchman, Girard, and not to the newest historical critical theories about the genesis of the both and the Old and the New Testament. And not only did he criticize Schwager in private, but also publicly at conferences. So much so that one day at such a conference, he overheard a colleague of Schwager's indignantly telling Schwager that if he had such an insolent assistant, he would get rid of him as soon as possible. Schwager's gentlemanly reply, "I have experienced worse from him," struck him deeply. This was a man whose insights obviously went deeper than the intellectual trivia he, Niewiadomski, had used to criticize him. Józef Niewiadomski began to read Schwager's theology and Girard's theory with new eyes and found that Schwager had not committed himself to this line of thinking without reason. Here was a new kind of theology sensitive to processes of mimetic rivalry and violence, but also inspired by the conviction that there was a power to living in a mimetic world but not becoming the slave of it, a power even capable of transforming the dynamics of mimetic desire even in the teacher-student relationship. The tremendous thing was the student Józef Niewiadomski had already come to realize that his teacher Schwager was the living proof of this, that this was actually true. From this day on, he committed himself to being a teacher by passing on this thinking to others in his signature dramatic style. I think this is the secret to his success as a teacher who did not fall prey to the master-slave dialectic. He became a fervent teacher of Schwager's dramatic theology by staying a fervent student of Schwager's. Every student of his knows that he is not interested in making people the disciples of his very own theology, but only in introducing them into a fascinating way of thinking which he learned from somebody else and is still in the process of learning. How precisely he managed to tame the demons of the teacher-student relationship by containing them within himself, not allowing them to interfere in his dealings with his own students, I do not know. I'm neither his psychotherapist nor his confessor. What I do know as a student is that he not only overcame the pitfalls of the master-slave dialectic vis-a-vis his teacher Schwager, but also enabled me, by the example of his life as a teacher, to overcome them vis-a-vis himself. He showed me that we are all at the receiving end of wisdom, which, theologically speaking, is always given to us not by accomplishment, but by grace. To happily live this insight, as he does, in the face of silly students like myself, I believe, in itself is a work of grace. Therefore, I would like to take the opportunity to thank him with all my heart for being a unique teacher who did not give up on me or so many others because of my insolent ambition like Socrates did and Alcibiades or like Melanchthon did virtually in all students. I know for a fact that this is also a work of grace in my life, which at least partly freed me from the self-deceptive ambition of the student towards his teacher. So, to express my gratitude towards Józef Wiadomski, let me conclude by wholeheartedly quoting words written by Raimund Schwager to René Girard in a letter from 1976. I thank God in my prayers that he has given you this wisdom. At the same time, this prayer is the means for me to avoid falling onto an absurd rivalry by taking you as a model, master of thought. And never forget, I am the one who made you feel like Caravaggio.
I put away these bloody images which scare me. So where's mine? Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, I'm the third in the row. For me it's a little bit more difficult to be honest. When Nicky Wandinger asked me to contribute to this session a long time ago, as a longtime companion of Josef, I thought a little bit about the family constellation in the Schwager group in Innsbruck. And Josef is definitely my elder brother in this regard. In view of mimetic theory, we could probably inquire about some sibling rivalry between us, but I will not reflect on that. I mean, that can remain to the Freudian couch or to the confession box. I will instead focus on another tension that follows from the different theological disciplines to which we both belong. And so, contrary to what I said to Nikki, I will also talk about Josef indirectly as a teacher. Josef, and I'm talking about the discipline, not the attitude, is a dogmatist, where I am an ethicist. Those who teach ethics or moral theology are always in danger of putting too much emphasis on our own efforts and forget about grace as an essential requirement for all our endeavors. Theologically speaking, ethicists are always in danger to succumb to semi-Pelagianism, at least. It was Josef who taught me the importance of grace, and grace was already mentioned twice as a central insight. One of his key insights is the transformational experience that the Eucharist provides for us. It is an experience of grace. I want to illustrate this experience with the help of literary examples, and as a storyteller, I know he likes literary examples, also movies based on literature. Babette's Feast, the Danish movie from 1987, based on a story by Karen Blixen, would be a great and good example. You mentioned it at the DS Facultatis recently. I know Josef likes this film and uses it sometimes to illustrate the importance of grace. But I think I have an even better example, a more interesting example, or an example that inspires me. This example is Virginia Woolf's novel To the Lighthouse from 1927. This novel shows, on the one hand, how strongly rights of exclusion dominate social life and provides, on the other hand, ways to overcome patterns of exclusion. We find the most striking example at the beginning of the novel, where Mrs. Ramsey recognized her husband's need for a scapegoat and quickly provided one for him. If her husband required sacrifices, and indeed he did, she cheerfully offered up to him Charles Densley, who had snubbed her little boy. To focus, however, on the overcoming of scapegoating, a dinner described in the novel in which Mrs. Ramsey plays a central role, and which also provides certain parallels to the Eucharist, is most important. The novel repeatedly highlights tensions and rivalries between different people. It's not by chance that the second part of this novel, with the title Time Passes, refers to the First World War as its historic background. Mimetic rivalries cause the tension that we can observe between different protagonists in the novel. Mr. Densley, he was already mentioned, for instance, is full of vanity and always wants to impress other people. He eagerly longs to blow up soon those mild, cultivated people by the gunpowder that was in him. Mr. Ramsey, in turn, became full of rage as one of the other guests asked for another bowl of soup. His anger fly like a pack of hounds into his eyes, his brows, and his wife knew that in a moment something violent would explode. An atmosphere full of tensions reigned at the beginning of the dinner. A threatening chaos dominated, and Mrs. Ramsey recognized the separateness characterizing the group that the shabbiness of the dining room also mirrored. The room was very shabby. There was no beauty anywhere. Nothing seemed to have merged. They all sat separate. And the whole of the effort of merging and flowing and creating rested on her. Again, she felt as a fact without hostility the sterility of men, for if she did not do it, nobody would do it. This violent separateness at the beginning of the meal turned slowly into a harmonious gathering of a well-connected community. This becomes most obvious as soon as the candles were lit up. Joseph likes candles too. And the threatening darkness outside bonded the people inside more and more together. Now all the candles were lit up, and the faces on both sides of the table were brought nearer by the candlelight and composed, as they had not been in the twilight, into a party round the table, for the night was now shut off by the panes of glass, which, far from giving any accurate view of the outside world, rippled it so strangely that here, inside the room, seemed to be order and dry land. There, outside, a reflection in which things waved and vanished waterily. Some change at once went through them all, as if they had really happened, and they were all conscious of making a party together in a hollow. On an island had a common cause against that fluidity out there. This description of the excluded night illustrates the power of rites of exclusion stemming from the scapegoat mechanism. However, it would be much too narrow interpretation of this dinner scene if you would only take this element of exclusion into account. The commitment of Mrs. Ramsey contributed much more to the success of the meal because she took care of all the needs and animosities of the whole group. She herself recognized the gift of peace, rest, and a taste of eternity that her commitment brought forward. Everything seemed right just now. Just now she had reached security. She hovered like a hawk suspended, like a flag floated in an element of joy which filled every nerve of her body fully and sweetly. Not noisily, solemnly rather, for it arose, she thought, looking at them all eating there, from husband and children and friends, all of which rising in this profound stillness. It partook, she felt, of eternity. There is a coherence in things, a stability, something she meant is immune from change and shines out. In the face of the flowing, the fleeting, the spectral, like a ruby, so that again tonight she had the feeling she had once, today already, of peace, of rest. Of such moments, she thought, the thing is made that endures. Even during the time that she had those thoughts that I just quoted, she was taking care of all the needs of the community at the dinner table. Mrs. Ramsey is an extraordinary example of self-giving because it is her caring and serving that leads to a successful dinner. It is this self-giving that comes close to the concept of pro-existence that we can find at the center of Joseph's theology of the Eucharist. Because Mrs. Ramsey was not involved in the mimetic rivalries and mitigated through her service the outbreak of violence in the group, she contributed to a transformation that shows clear affinities with the sacrament of the Eucharist. Justly, Lily Briscoe describes her in a later part of the novel as a perfect example of self-giving, juxtaposing Mrs. Ramsey to her husband, who could not give but only take. That man, Lily Briscoe thought, her anger rising in her, never gave. That man took. She, on the other hand, would be forced to give. Mrs. Ramsey had given, giving, giving, giving. She had died and had left all this. The example of Mrs. Ramsey shows clearly how the self-giving of a human being can transform rivalries and tensions between people so that a community occurs that no longer relies on exclusions and external enemies. The figure of Mrs. Ramsey helps us to approach the power of transformation that Joseph discovers at the center of the Eucharist. Joseph justly claims that types of communication that stem from the scapegoat mechanism and the Eucharist are perfect counter images. This, however, does not mean that there is no connection between them or that there is no transformation possible from exclusionary rites to the Eucharistic community. The attitude of pro-existence provides the transformation of exclusionary forms of communication. And Joseph now gets lifted up to the level of Virginia Woolf, a quote out of his contribution that he did with Matthias Scharrer a couple of years ago, writes, "The Eucharistic community is not a community beyond the vicious cycle of handing over someone and subjection, expelling someone or being expelled. Due to the pro-existing attitude of many that became densified in the unambiguity of Jesus' self-giving, has the community way through the vicious cycles become possible and real." Mrs. Ramsey, however, and now I'm going back to the question of grace that I, as an ethicist, have to learn. Mrs. Ramsey is not a superhero that we have to imitate in a Pelagian way. Her ability to provide peace, rest, and a foretaste of eternity to people surrounding her roots in her own mysticism. In a very interesting passage in the novel, Virginia Woolf shows how in a moment of silence and solitude, Mrs. Ramsey freed herself from all attachments, losing even close to a Christian understanding of kenosis, personality, and experienced peace, rest, and eternity, so much so that she suddenly said to herself, "We are in the hands of the Lord." Such an uttering seems to suggest that she is a traditional Christian. Virginia Woolf, however, Mrs. Ramsey, did not believe in God in any traditional way. Suffering, death, and the poor in this world kept her away from traditional faith. She immediately criticized herself for saying, "We are in the hands of the Lord." And I do something what the deconstructionists do, you know, to write it and delete it in some way. Despite, and that's also interesting, her distancing from traditionally believing in God, however, her type of mysticism is close to the mysticism that we can discover in the final chapter of René Girard's The Cities I and the novel, comprising Christian authors like Dostoevsky and agnostics like Marcel Proust. For this reason, we can also discover interesting parallels between Mrs. Ramsey and the French philosopher and mystic Simone Weil. Moreover, concerning environmental challenges we face today, I should not forget to mention that Mrs. Ramsey's mysticism has close affinities with St. Francis of Assisi and Pope Francis' encyclical Laudato Si, and Michel Serres, who deceased recently, emphasized the parallel to St. Francis of Assisi in an essay on To the Lighthouse. Mrs. Ramsey's mysticism is definitely a kenotic opening up for grace when she describes a mystical union with inanimate things like trees, streams, flowers, as turning herself into a bride to meet her lover. Joseph, by teaching me the importance of grace, you reminded me repeatedly of the Pelagian fallacy. I was not, and it will continue, this teaching, not always able to avoid this trap, but remain grateful that you have given others and me direction. Ethicists, for sure, need to cooperate with dogmaticians. Thank you very much.
After these four brilliant English speakers, you have to endure a Polish-German-English, which is not very good, but it's an exercise of humility for me. I always wanted to speak good English, and I didn't really, I can't do it. So, actually, I did not want this session. More or less, I have been forced, so I've been a victim of this evening. Now I know Nikki is the perpetrator. Yeah. The first time I really realized meeting you, it was in the church after a sermon. Yeah, you don't know it. It was the Frommenein Skandal. That was the sermon, yeah. I remember. Yeah. Many thanks for Nikki, Wolfgang, Karin, Matthias, yeah. It made me cry a little bit, and the others who planned and prepared this session. Many thanks, of course, to the Raven Foundation, which generously sponsored the reception afterward. Susan and Kite, I am very honored. Thank you very much. Thank you to you all who are here. What more can I say? It's late. So Nikki said there will be discussion. I look for my watch and I have 15. There's a 15 minute to the buffet, so we can sketch the discussion. There is no discussion at all. The dogmatician, yeah, I left. But after Karin has mentioned a text that goes back to a sermon, and Wolfgang spoke about Eucharist, and the sermon must come to the Eucharist in the Catholic way. And I am a passionate preacher, and preaching is not something we are going to be a rival, annoyed. So I would suggest put yourself in the situation of preaching. Susan wanted that I do this. It is probably my best Girardian sermon. Some of you will know it. So that's a sermon, which will be not so really good performed like in German. It did not go that far this time. The archaic story, a story which repeats itself over and over again and thus also becomes a modern story, this story was interrupted. It all has started like it always does. The plot developed in full accordance with the archaic script. They had always been chasing her, giving her ambiguous looks, were hissing at her in the streets, tried to casually fill her up at dances, and wanted only one thing of her. Had she not seen it? Not noticed it? Of course she had. And depending on who it was that had given her that look, she did or did not enjoy the experience. She too mastered the archaic game of flirtation, this game that humans have played from the dawn of time. And the husband knew about it too. And it made him proud that his wife remained an object of desire, for it increased her value and increased his value. He was the husband of a local beauty. And all of them were playing with the fire, and several among them even crossed the boundary. They not only played, but gave themselves to be consumed by that fire, in secret only, of course. While adultery was not a daily routine, it was not the event of a lifetime either. It was part of everyday life, as so many other things. But now the woman is caught. In the very act, was it an accident or a trap? That is not the central question. She is now forcefully dragged through the town, humiliated. Now, finally, each man can take by force what his fantasy had been structuring for a long time. The crowd swells. Who all is in it? Is it only the yelling men full of vitality? No, the old ones are running right along. Instinctively, they had understood that this is their chance to take vengeance on the young woman. Even though she had not done them any harm, she simply was young and beautiful and loved life. That was enough for the elderly to join the turba, the mob to join the breathless crowd that was chasing her. And the women are not absent either. There are those women who had never been able to stand her because she captured the fantasy of their lovers or even their husbands. And the children were not absent either. Those in puberty understood all too well what was at stake here. A communication system that structures the boring daily routine of the elders was about to collapse. The amalgam of morals, rules, and taboos, which more or less defined their parents' life, the bourgeois morality was collapsing. If that was not a once-a-year chance to catch their fathers and mothers taking off their false moral veneer, the only one thing the young ones did not want to see, namely that they resembled their fathers and mothers to a T. And finally, the husband was not absent either. His earlier pride in the fact that his wife was an object of desire now changed in view of the current mood. It became hatred. Suddenly, she has become a slut and a hooker in his eyes. And what about her, the adulteress? At the latest, when the sweaty hands of the yelling man were dragging her from her lover's bed, then at the latest she knew that she had sinned. More than that, she knew that she deserved being stoned. Naturally, fear and sheer panic gripped her. Naturally, she desired to go on living, much like any human does. But staring in the eyes of her accusers, she had something like a revelation. Through the hate-filled eyes, she was looking into the very window of God, and there she found the age-old wisdom. If only you had not started it. It's your own fault. Addio, omnisperanza. The eyes of God, she saw in the eyes of these men who were chasing her. These eyes were ruthless. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such a woman. Had you forgotten that? Yet, it is an archaic story and a modern one. A story that repeats itself over and over again, always following the same pattern. It is but the victims who change. They have different names, and the reasons why the mob wants to lynch them change as well. Often a hint, a suspicion, it all takes. And if there is nothing else, even the evil eye will do at times. His story was no different either. Job's history too follows the ancient playbook on casting out, isolating, throwing stones. Job too slipped into the victim role. Why? We do not know. Too often has his story been retold. Too many storytellers wanted to explain to the following generation from their own understanding what really had been going on there. One thing alone is certain. The closed circle of enemy and friends. All of them isolate the one. Job is surrounded by a mob, by a turba. He's as much alone in the crowd as the adulteress is among those who chase her. Who else is with him? Is his wife? She mocks him and gives him a look, filled with disgust that hits Job like a stone. When you finally croak that I can have my own life. Or are they three proven friends? They have now come. They sit and remain silent for a week. What kind of thoughts cross their minds during that time? Boy, oh boy, he's really been hit. If I was in such bad shape, I would make an end of it. Boy, I'm happy that he's now so covered with growth, that he stinks so bad that I don't have to shake his hand. And his expression on his face, like a dog begging for sympathy. But how am I to show him sympathy? He knew very well what he was getting himself into. It's his own fault. For one thing is certain, he's not suffering without a cause. I would be curious to know, however, what offense he has committed. Enough of that silence business. Well, now, don't you lie to us. What have you done? Now that there is nothing left for you to lose, confess. Speak. But he does not wish to speak. And he is barely able to. His tongue sticks to his palate. His throat is dry. No one makes sure to get him something to drink. Now at this very moment, when all they are interested in his guilt, now they are coming together, closer, taking him his air to breathe, and they grow more and more. The younger they are, the smarter they be. They talk, speaking faster and faster. And with more pathos, I cannot stand their talk, their arguments, and the continual babble of sin and punishment. I can no longer endure it. No! Job is himself taken aback by his sudden outcry at the day suddenly have fallen silent. No, I am not guilty. The cynical looks of his friends hit him like stones. Are you joking? Please do not get me wrong. I have done nothing different from what you all have done. I have never claimed to be a saint. I was neither an ascetic nor a secret criminal. I have done nothing that would warrant my current state, my sickness, and most of all, your attitude toward me. No sooner that these words left Job's mouth, the verbal stoning began. And there was not a single person who would not have share in it. The friends, the well-represented citizen in the region, was simply the ringleaders. Order now have come from all over. There are those also who are eager to settle old accounts. Job had not given them and their father's jobs. Job had been snobbish towards them and thus had always been bothering them, had been an object of envy. But those are not the only ones taking part in the verbal stoning. Even the scum of the society is there, those who themselves are outcasts of society, thieves, stupid underlings, anomalous rabble, bums, people living in holes, all those who are beaten down daily, all these jump on his singular opportunity to take part to mock one who has fallen a step lower than themselves. At the latest, when the very scum of society had joined his enemies, his friends, and his wife, then, at the very latest, Job too knew what the adulteress knew, that there was no escape for him. Just like the adulteress, he could now discern this age-old wisdom in the eyes of those chasing him, that God had now become his cruel enemy and is leading him nowhere but to death, whether it happens through stones or words, but stares of silent mob. Where is the difference? Just like the adulteress, all he had left to do was to think remorsefully. I hoped for good, but evil came. I waited for the light, but darkness came. I wanted love, but there comes only death. Addio, ogni speranza. Job's story, however, was interrupted. In the face of the stoning looks of his friends and foes, Job cries out, I know that my Redeemer liveth. And he does not fail to notice that they react by even more cynical and sarcastic looks. In this, they are all akin to the post-Marxist enlighteners of our day, religion. This simply is the opium for the poor victims. Job's cry seems to fade in empty space. Why? Maybe because there was no one there who would have lent credibility to his outcry. There was no one there to break through the apparent plausibility. There was no one there who would have demonstrated solidarity, showing empathy and compassion, and thus working the miracle of integration. As I have said, no even the poorest of the poor, no even the outsiders were able to do this. This is, however, the decisive difference from the adulteress drama. In her case, there was one. Jesus was able to interrupt the archaic story of the stoning, even though, in contrast to Job, the woman had brought the judgment on herself and did not expect anything others at all than what those chasing her believed she deserved, death by stoning. Why was Jesus able to do what none of Job's friends or foes had been able to do? like no other. He was sustained by the faith that God was a boundless lover of life, and that especially in causes where life is put into question, where life is under threat, he does not show his good head by affirming that threat, by sanctioning it, let alone by taking it to its very end, thereby also destroying life. But rather, then God saves this life and so shows himself to be God. He was sustained by the faith that God saves, saves through the breach, saves through the exclusion, saves through sickness, yes, even through death. And this he does even if the trait is self-inflicted. Even if the trait is self-inflicted. Even then God rides straight on the crooked lines. And Jesus was even more radically different from the post-Marxist enlighteners and their archaic friends of Job's by virtue of the fact that he did not understand his faith to be the opium of the poor, but rather as the true movements of his own life, as the reason for his own existence. That's why he did not join the crowd chasing the woman and did not show a cynical smile for the hopes of the suffering, the excluded, the hunted. Moved by this faith in God, the lover of life, moved by the faith in the God who saves life, moved by the faith, he went to the sick, went to the outcast, to the hunted, and he went to them not to stone them with his words, not to teach them about the correlation between guilt and punishment, not to put them down in their calamity and to totally destroy their damaged self-confidence and self-esteem. No, he went to them to save them, or at least to show them compassion, and so to lend plausibility to their hope that their Redeemer liveth. This too is the reason why he interrupts the story of the adulterous stoning. But this interruption is by no means without consequence. It is continued in another circle and another victim, and this new victim now is Jesus himself. The logic is still the same. Despised and mocked by all, the one who has so often lifted his voice in the defense of others, he is now not opening his mouth like a lamb being led to its slaughter. Little by little, more and more people join the crowd of those hunting him, while those who would like to support him fail. They flee or they betray him. Even the one in whom he had trusted all his life. The one he knew saved life and did not destroy it. Even this one now seemed to have forsaken him. My God, why have you forsaken me? There was no answer. Never before had a man had such complete trust in God. Never before had being forsaken felt so painful and bitter. In Jesus' death, God and nothing less seem to have become identical. The post-Marxist enlightener can once again sport his cynical grin. Addio, ogni speranza. But this story too was interrupted. Interrupted in a way that no one had expected. It was interrupted by God himself, the lover of life, he who took the horrible death, the most radical God-forsakenness, transformed it into life. And this interruption gifts us with a new look into the window of God. This window, this view into the heaven of God through the lens of the crucified and risen one says but one thing too. There is nothing that could put a limit on the life-giving power of God, nor the